Hey, you know, I would just agree with Pastor Daniel about these life groups, and I would encourage you to get signed up like sooner rather than later, because they're filling up really fast. We have 30 some groups, and they're filling up really, really fast. We do a group at our home, and it's full. They put it online last week, and just like our family room only holds so many people, and so we have to put a limit on the number of people, and it just filled up really fast. So make sure that you get signed up for one of those life groups. And essentially this, we were created by God for connection. We really were, all of us, and even we introverts. Believe it or not, we were created for connection, to connect with other people. And that kind of ties into the series that we've been doing on Wednesday nights. We're calling it Connected. But we're talking about connecting with God. And I really, really believe that that's God's heart for you, that He wants to have this connectedness with each and every one of us. And so we're going to continue this series. And this will be actually our last message in the series. And in this series, we're going to take a look tonight at the prayer that Paul prayed for the church in Ephesus. So the principle behind what we've been doing in this series is we've been taking a look at prayers that were prayed in the Bible. And of course, there are tons of them. And they're so encouraging to read, because God answers prayer. And James wrote in the scripture, he said, the effectual fervent prayer of the righteous avails much. And I don't think we really comprehend all that prayer can accomplish. And so these prayers, not only do they encourage us to pray, but they also instruct us on how to pray. Because I think if we're honest, most of us believers would say that prayer can be an area of struggle for us. For some reason, the enemy just jumps in the middle of this topic to discourage us, either that we're not praying enough, or that our prayers are ineffective. And so he jumps right in the middle of that and brings condemnation. But what we have attempted to do in this series is to bring some encouragement and some instruction, but also to simplify prayer. Because at its very base, prayer is communication. And so it's a conversation between you and God. And so every one of us, we have the aptitude to be able to do that. We talk all the time, every day, to people. And God says, hey, don't leave me out of that equation. I want to talk to you. And a big part, of course, of communication is talking. But in relation to talking to God, perhaps it's more important for Him to talk to us and for us to put ourselves in a position to be able to hear His voice and Him speaking to us in our lives. And He really wants to do that, I believe. And many, many, many times I know that I've gone to the Lord in prayer, and I've said my piece, and then I've got up and walked out, and I've had this sense that God was like, but wait, don't leave yet. You've done a lot of talking. Now I want to talk to you. And so a big part of prayer is learning how to listen to the voice of God. And so we're going to take a look at an aspect of prayer this evening that's called intercession. And again, in an attempt to keep things simple, intercessory prayer is simply this. It's prayer offered on behalf of another. It's prayer offered on behalf of another. Sometimes we get so caught up in our own lives and our own needs that we neglect the fact that God has called each and every one of us to stand in the gap for others. Standing in the gap means that we talk to God on behalf of someone else. E.M. Bounds, in his classic book, Power Through Prayer, said it this way. He said, talking to men for God is a great thing, but talking to God for men is greater still. And there's a lot of truth to that. The term stand in the gap appears in the Bible during the time of the prophet Ezekiel, and God's people had strayed away from the Lord, and so God spoke to them saying this in Ezekiel 22:30. He said, I searched for a man to stand in the gap before me, to intercede with God on behalf of the people. And he went on to say, but I found none. And that's kind of a tragic passage when you think about it, that the people of God are straying away from the Lord, and God's saying, I'm looking for someone that'll just stand in the gap for these people that are straying from the Lord. And God ended up saying, I can't find anybody. God has always searched for a people who would stand in the gap for others. Think about Abraham, who pleaded for God to spare Sodom and Gomorrah, wicked Sodom and Gomorrah. And he said, God, would you spare it for 50 righteous people? And God said, absolutely. And then Abraham gets to thinking, well, how about 40? And you know this negotiation went, how about 30? How about 20? How about 10? And God said, yeah. But finally, the cities became destroyed because they couldn't even find 10 righteous. But there were some, because of the prayer of Abraham, Lot and his family were spared. Moses pleaded with God to spare the Israelites and to forgive them of their sin when they made this golden idol to worship. In regards to this event, the psalmist would later write, the Lord said in Psalm 106:23, he would destroy them had not Moses, his chosen one, stood in the breach before him to turn away his wrath. And so a person that's standing in the gap or standing in the breach is so critical in regards to the salvation of other people or the saving of a nation or the healing of a sick person, whatever the situation might be. And so in last week's teaching, we saw that Jesus himself is the greatest example of intercessory prayer. Remember these verses in Romans 3:34, Christ Jesus is he who died, yes, rather who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who also intercedes for us. And that's a great truth, and it's a beautiful example of intercessory prayer that Jesus exists in eternity right now interceding for us. And that's a powerful thing. And then the scripture in Hebrews says this, Christ ever lives to make intercession for us. In the early days of the church, the Apostle Paul became a champion of intercessory prayer. He prayed for Timothy. He prayed for Philemon. He prayed for the believers in Rome. He prayed for the believers in Corinth, in Philippi, in Colossae, in Thessalonica. Tonight, we're going to take a look at Paul's prayer for the believers in Ephesus, which provides us with an amazing model of what intercession looks like and how we, you and I, can effectively pray for other people. And then we're going to do something a little bit different at the end of this service tonight, and I'll cue you in to that as when we get there. But Paul writes this to the believers in Ephesus, chapter 1, verse 15, and we're just going to go down through some of the verses here in the book of Ephesians, chapter 1. So beginning at verses 15 and 16, if you have a Bible or a Bible app, or if you have the Highlands app, the notes are there. It'll also be on the screen. But here's what Paul says, for this reason, ever since I heard about your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love for all of God's people, I have not stopped giving thanks for you, remembering you in my prayer. So Paul is essentially telling these believers, hey guys, I'm praying for you. I'm interceding for you. I'm believing God for whatever is going on in your situation, in your life in Christ. I'm praying for you. And that's a powerful thing in and of itself, to have somebody that's praying for us, isn't it? To know that somebody's praying for us. But here's what I think is important. You can be that person for somebody else. So it's not always just about somebody praying for me and for us, but it's also us becoming that person that's praying for other people. And I would say this, that it's very likely, think about this, as parents, you might be the only person who's standing in the gap for your kids. Or to think about it this way, you might be the only person standing in the gap for that really close, longtime friend that you've had that doesn't yet know the Lord. Or maybe they do know the Lord, but maybe they don't have anybody else praying for them, interceding for them. And I think for us to begin to think that way, to realize that God has positioned us in the sphere of life that He's positioned us, sometimes I believe for the purpose of praying for those that He's put within our community, in our sphere. And so the first thing that Paul mentions in praying for the believers in Ephesus is this. And as we go through these, we want to relate them to. So this is some instruction on how we can pray for others. Because if you're like me, sometimes you come up short. It's like I'm at a loss as to how to pray for someone. And so Paul gives us some instruction in this. The first thing is this, that they may come to know the Lord better. And here's what it looks like in Ephesians. Paul goes on to write, I keep asking that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the glorious Father, may give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation so that you may know Him better. And so Paul is praying this prayer for these believers that they might come to know the Lord better. And I would suggest tonight that prayer, when you are interceding for someone, praying for someone, no matter who it is, it would be well served for you to pray that they might come to know the Lord better. That would always be a prayer that's in God's will and plan, that we would come to know Him better. So if you're ever at a loss as to how to pray for someone, you can always pray this prayer, God, that they might come to know You better, that You would reveal Yourself to this person in a greater way. If we're praying for someone who isn't saved, the most important prayer that we could pray for them is that they would come to know the Lord. That's the most important prayer. A lot of times, I noticed this, that when I was working a secular job, I taught in the public school for 15 years, and as you become entrenched in that culture there among your coworkers, and issues in their lives come up, situations come up, and they know that you're a believer, they're always coming and saying, could you pray for me? And they would tell about a situation that would come up. And I think it's a beautiful place to be when you have a testimony among your coworkers or your neighbors or your friends or your family, where when something comes up, they are asking you for prayer. I think that's a beautiful thing. But we have to also be aware that as we pray over the situation that our friends or our coworkers or our family members are dealing with, that we not just pray that God gives them a job or takes care of this financial situation or whatever, or brings healing to their body, but we recognize the fact the most important prayer that we can pray is that they would be saved. And we could do it this way. God, here's the prayer. Would You bring healing to this situation, or would You provide housing for them, or whatever the need is, and in doing so, that they would come to recognize that You care about them and that they would give their hearts to Christ. You see, that's the most important prayer that we can pray for someone. Mark, in chapter 8, verse 36, writes, what will it profit a man if he gains the whole world but loses his soul? Three things that you can always pray for the unsaved. Number one is this, that they desire to know God or hunger after the Lord. If you have someone that you have been praying for, that they would come to know the Lord, pray that they would get an insatiable hunger and thirst for God. And then watch what happens. Just watch what happens. Secondly, we can pray that God would send a messenger to them. And Paul writes about this. How can they hear without a preacher? Or how can they hear without somebody that's sent that will tell them about Christ? And I might suggest that someone might be you. It might be you, but maybe you've already done that. And sometimes they'll just need another voice. They'll need to cross paths with someone else that's a believer that can give them a powerful testimony about what God has done in their life. And so pray that God would send a messenger to that person. And then we can also pray that they would come to understand the gospel. See, pray that God would remove the scales from their eyes, as it were, and they would be able to perceive and see the truth of the gospel message, and that their hearts would be convicted. See, if we are praying then for someone who is saved, it might look a little bit different. We can pray like Paul did, that they may come to know the Lord better, that they would grow in their faith, that this is always within God's will, purpose, plan for us to pray. The second thing that Paul prayed for the believers in Ephesus is this: that they would walk in the fullness of God's promises and blessings. You see, this is a powerful prayer, and here's what it looks like in Ephesians chapter 1, verse 18, as Paul continues this prayer. He says, I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened in order that you may know the hope to which he has called you, the riches of his glorious inheritance. And I think this is especially powerful for we parents, because as we pray for our children, one of the things that we can pray for them is that they would be able to see and determine and understand that God has a plan and a purpose for their life, and for them to discover what that plan and purpose is. And again, I would suggest, if you're not praying that prayer for them, who is? Who is? Their teacher? Their principal? Their best friend's mom? Maybe, if they're believers, but possibly not. The only person that may be praying that prayer, that God would help them to understand the fullness of his promises and blessings for their life, might be you. You might be the person that's praying that prayer for them or for anyone else. Paul says, pray this prayer, that this person that you're praying for would come to a full understanding of God's promises and blessings in their life. See, here's one of the things that I'm convinced of, that we as believers, we often get so entrenched in the world and the culture and what we live in, and also in the situations and the problems and the challenges that we deal with, that sometimes the promises and the blessings that God has for us are clouded out. And I just want to encourage you with this, that God has so many promises and so many blessings in store for you as a believer. And a lot of times we just live way, 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 way short of the promises and the blessings that God has available to us. And what's interesting is Paul mentions earlier in the chapter that we have been adopted as sons and daughters. And there was a point at which in the conversation with Jesus between his disciples and his followers, he said this to them. He said, I don't want you to call me master anymore. I want you to call me friend. You see, that's the kind of relationship that Jesus is inviting every one of us into, is this friendship relationship with him. And in this passage, Paul is telling these believers that you have been adopted. You are God's sons and daughters. And as God's sons and daughters, you need to recognize that that's a promise and a blessing for you. But sometimes we live beneath that. And then Paul also elaborates on the promises as he continues to write. And here's some of the promises and blessings that he reminds them of, that he has forgiven us of our sins. We're forgiven. What a blessing, forgiven. Sin, all of the sin has been erased, eradicated, it's gone. It's under the blood of Jesus. And when Jesus looks at you and your sins have been covered by the blood, he doesn't see your faults and your failures and your shortcomings. He sees the blood of Jesus. He sees that blood. He reminds them that he is rich in mercy and that he loves us, that we are his workmanship. He reminds us that he is our peace, that we have access to the Father through Jesus Christ. You have access to the Father. We are a dwelling place for the Holy Spirit, the Bible says, and Paul reminds them, a dwelling place for the Spirit of Almighty God. That upon confessing Christ as our Savior, he puts his precious Spirit in us. He reminds them and us that he is able to do abundantly beyond all that we can ask or think. You see, and Paul is praying for these believers that they would walk in the fullness of all those promises and blessings. And I would remind all of us here today, not only to walk in the fullness of all of those promises and blessings, but that we put it in our agenda as we pray for others, whether it be our children, our coworkers, other family members, friends, that we would be praying that they would discover the riches of God's promises and blessings in their life. And then finally, Paul prays that they would receive power and strength from the Lord. In Ephesians, continuing his prayer in verse 19 to 21, he says, I pray that you may know his incomparably great power for us who believe. That power is the same as the mighty strength he extended when he raised Christ from the dead and seated him at the right hand of God in heavenly realms, far above all rule and authority, power and dominion, and every name that is invoked, not only in the present age, but also in the one to come. You see, Paul is saying here to intercede and to pray for others that they might receive the power and the strength of the Lord. I think daily, it's a daily occurrence for us now to encounter people who are fearful, who have all kinds of anxiety, who are depressed, who are overwhelmed, who are just afraid of the situation, the things that are going on. I think it's common for us to encounter people in those situations today. And if there's ever been a time that we needed to pray and ask God to reveal his power and his strength. And that's what Paul is saying here. Paul further explains where this strength comes from In the third chapter of Ephesians, he clarifies, where does this strength come from? He says, I pray that out of his glorious riches, he may strengthen you with power through his Spirit in your inner being. This power that we're talking about comes from the Spirit of the Lord. It's a spiritual thing. And we're interceding and praying, God, give power and strength where it's needed. And finally, in Ephesians 6:10, Paul says, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. See, the Lord wants to give the believer both supernatural power and strength to be able to deal with whatever situation might come our way. And I know this, that if you're going through a difficult season, a difficult situation, that you will get through that situation. Because God gives you power to get through that situation through the Spirit that he's placed within you. The enemy might be great, but the power of God is greater. The power of God is greater. And sometimes as we intercede and as we pray for others, our prayer becomes, God, give them the power and the strength that they need to get through this situation. And we're praying that God would give them the power that they need. And so, in closing tonight, I want us to come back to the first part of Paul's prayer where he prayed for the Ephesians that they would come to know the Lord better. And I want to ask you this question. Is that your desire tonight? Is that your desire to come to know the Lord better? No matter where you are, maybe you've never been invited to open your heart to Christ. Maybe you've never prayed a prayer inviting Christ to come into your life. Or maybe you've been a believer for a really, really long time. That prayer applies to every one of us, that we would come to know the Lord better. And that's his heart for each and every one of us, that we would come to know him in a deeper, richer, more full way. Jesus said, I've come to give you life and that more abundantly. And so I want us to bow our heads, close our eyes tonight as we pray together. And for those of you that the answer to that question, do you want him to draw you closer? If the answer to that question is yes, I do, then as we pray tonight and you open your heart to him, just sense him doing exactly that, drawing your heart closer. But there may be some here tonight, you've never prayed a prayer inviting Christ to come into your life. And before you leave tonight, I want to give you that opportunity. Both those of you that have joined us online and those that are in the room with us, I'm inviting you to pray this prayer, inviting Christ to come into your heart, into your life. And the advantage for those of you that are in the room with us is that I'm going to ask you, if you'd like to pray that prayer, you just lift up your hand and say, that's me, I want to pray that prayer, I want to invite Christ into my life tonight. And you just slip your hand up, right back down, and I'll agree with you, and we'll pray together, and I'll lead you in that prayer. Are you here? In the room? Yes, I want to pray that prayer. I want to invite Christ into my heart. I see your hand right over here. Anybody else? Just real quick, nobody's looking around. This is just between you and the Lord. And then for those of you that have joined us online, I would invite you to pray this prayer with us as well. Just pray these words. Lord, I ask tonight as I come to you and open my heart that you would forgive me of my sins. Just pray that prayer. Lord, forgive me of my sins. I ask that you'd put your Spirit within me. I thank you for making provision for this by coming to this earth, laying your life down on the cross, dying in my place so that I could have forgiveness of sins. And I thank you, God, for allowing me to enter a relationship with you. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.